wanted to ask you about Home Secretary's here. Good morning to you. Wanted to ask you about that. I obviously want to ask you about the polls, but what are we doing to support those that need medical aid from Gaza?
Well, the UK government has been really very active in not just donating aid to Gaza, but also liaising with both the Israeli authorities and the Egyptian authorities and others in the region that have influence to try and get the aid through to Gaza. So stories like that, of course, are really lovely to see. But ultimately, to make a real difference to the many, many people in Gaza, we need this conflict to come to a conclusion. For that to happen, we need the hostages, the Israeli hostages, to be released. We need the aid to get through. And all these things are what we're working on.
But would you rule out specialist care for those that need it to potentially be brought to the UK?
Well, look, there are a whole load of complications about getting people out of Gaza. There are British nationals in Gaza that we're still looking to get out, and that has got to be our priority. But as I say, the best way of helping the most people most quickly is for Hamas to release the hostages, bring this conflict to a conclusion and get the aid, which is sitting ready to go through the Rafah crossing actually into Gaza. And those are the things we're working on.
But Home Secretary, Qatar, the United Arab Emirates, Turkey, Italy, France, Malta and the US have all taken people. Why not the UK?
But as I say, there are always complications with regard to this getting people out. But as I say, in order to have the most effect to the most people most quickly, getting the aid that is ready and waiting near the Rafah crossing, actually into Gaza, has got to remain our priority, and that's what we're focusing on.
Talk to me about last night's poll.
Well, look, I know it's a cliche, but we are focusing exclusively on the one poll that really matters, which is the one on the 4th of July.
This must have stung, though.
Well, look, if you were asking, would I prefer going into the last few weeks of this election campaign with the polls in our favour? Of course, I would prefer that. But the fact of the matter is, when I knock on doors, as I was doing yesterday and I'll be doing later on today, what I'm hearing is people completely unconvinced by Labour. Now, that means that we have got a job to do, making sure that we get our case across, that Keir Starmer has spectacularly failed to convince the voters that I speak to that he has got a plan for this country. And I think whether it's through the debates tonight or through the next couple of weeks, increasingly British people will see that at these turbulent times, handing control of the country to a man who doesn't even really seem to be in control of his own shadow cabinet is probably not a good idea.
You talk about cabinets. I mean, Jeremy Hunt, Grant Shapps, Penny Mordaunt, Mark Harper, Alex Chalk, Mel Stride, Johnny Mercer, Esther McVeigh, Simon Hart, Victoria Prentice, David Davis, Gillian Keegan, Jacob Rees-Mogg would all lose their seats if this poll comes to pass. You're going to get battered, according to this.
Well, the whole point of election campaigns is that you make your case to the British people. And as I say, when I've spoken to people, they want to hear what our plan is for the future. They want to hear about what we'll do to continue putting downward pressure on immigration, on inflation levels, getting interest rates back down to normal levels, to get more police on the streets, as we have done. And when they compare that with Labour, when I say, are you thinking about voting Labour? You know, people scrunch up their faces and they go, no, they're not convinced by Keir Starmer. I think all this flip-flopping that we've seen, well, all this is not the conversation that I'm hearing. So
yeah, but your seat is a 24,000-seat majority.
I don't only campaign in my seat. I've been across a number of other constituencies. Of course, I campaign to be re-elected myself, but I think for someone in my position as a member of the cabinet, I think it's also incumbent that
we support colleagues.
It's like you're
going to be the only one left.
And I have been doing that, and whether it's in Wales where I was campaigning, across a number of other places, including the home counties.
Can't imagine you're going to win many seats in Wales.
People are not well. When I was in Barry, knocking on a door in Barry, the kind of place where you'd expect Labour to have a huge amount of support.
Conservatives would plummet to 140 seats. Let me just tell you this, because you
mentioned
Wales.
The person I was speaking to, when I said, are you thinking of voting Labour, she scrunched up her face and she said, no, I don't like Keir Starmer and I don't know what they stand for.
Going to be wiped out in Wales, according to this poll.
Well, as I say, that's not what I was hearing when I was actually knocking on doors in Wales.
Can you acknowledge that at least it made you wince a little bit?
No, because, look, the point is,
so what was your reaction when you saw it?
My reaction was to get on with campaigning, because whether the polls are accurate, and as I say, I'm not convinced they are, or whether they're not, the best thing for us to do as candidates and for Rishi Sunak to do is to continue taking our plan to the British people. And we have got a plan to bring down immigration through through the policy that we're announcing today.
Because your
and
boss,
put more police on the streets and increase defence spending, etc., etc.
As far as immigration is concerned, certainly illegal immigration, your boss said that the numbers had come down 36% last year. According to the latest figures in April, those are the latest we've got, I'm sure you have others that you may be able to share with us, it's gone up 24%.
Well, what we have seen is that the people smugglers have been changing their tactics as we've been pressure to them. So we have got a small boats operational command. And I'll touch on that again in a second, if I may, which is working with the law enforcement authorities on the Channel, interrupting the supply of boats, interrupting the supply of engines, because of course, without boats and engines, it makes it harder. And when I look at Labour Party, and I think this is, and this goes to the point I'm saying about a lack of plan on illegal migration, which is a really tough international issue. Yvette Cooper's big reveal was this border command.
Talking about your plans.
And the point is that already exists. It's called the Small Boats Operational Command.
Okay.
It's commanded by a former British Army general. Now either Yvette Cooper doesn't know the Small Boats Operational Command exists, which is really embarrassing for the Shadow Home Secretary, or she does know it exists and she's lying to the British people.
Okay.
Neither of which is a particularly good look.
It's
an example of Labour's lack of a plan.
Okay, how are you feeling about Nigel Farage being in your county and hoping to be an MP?
Well, I'm surprised because the last time I heard him make reference to Clacton, he was saying that he didn't want to spend every Friday in Clacton. And that's the point
to
of
you.
The... That's the, well, I want to spend every Friday in Braintree and Houston, the lovely villages in North Essex. But the point is, reform has, I think, always been a vehicle for Nigel Farage's self-promotion. I think Richard Tice is now discovering that, rather painfully. And the point that we have made is that Keir Starmer would love people to vote reform because he knows that a vote for reform basically opens the door to a Labour government. And this is a Labour leader who took the knee during the BLM protest rather than standing up for our police officers, who has said that all immigration legislation is inherently racist, has got a shadow cabinet riddled with people that are unwilling to defend our country, won't match our 2.5% commitment on defence spending. A Labour government that represents the opposite of what I think the British people need. And a vote for reform will open the door to Labour government and they'll open the door to the
almost
country.
Almost out of time, but I do want to ask you about your campaign video. I'm sure you're aware of the challenges that are in that campaign video, are you? Have you seen overnight?
Look, when you put out a campaign video, you get criticism. It's what happens.
Yeah.
It's what happens.
But we're talking about the flag.
So it's a video of the flag. I'm not sure that...
Did you notice anything wrong with it?
So I noticed it actually when it was highlighted to me. When I watched the video, I was concentrating on our commitment to defence.
What's wrong
on
with
our
that flag?
Commitment? Well, I can see the video's obviously been transposed or it's been flown upside down. But
well,
the point
it'll be
is,
the latter, won't it?
Well, quite possibly. The majority of that video is about our commitment to defence spending, about putting more police on the beat, about protecting British people.
But we know.
If people want to obsess about
that
a flag flying
upside down means what?
No, it doesn't. This is complete nonsense.
Okay. It doesn't mean a distress signal.
No, it doesn't. It really doesn't.
I did check with top brass and they told me it did.
It really doesn't.
Okay.
It really doesn't. And the point is that video is about our commitment to protect the British people.
Are you going
to
recut it?
Is about our decision to commit to 2.5 for defence. Look, I don't think that's worth redoing a whole video over because the majority of that
just
video...
Just change the shot.
The majority of that video...
Is
about protecting the British people, something the Labour government...
It's a gaffe, though, isn't it?
Something a Labour government would spectacularly fail to do.
You've got to accept it's a gaffe.
I tell you what is a gaffe. Labour refusing to commit to 2.5 defence spending.
You're quite grumpy today. Have you been rattled by that poll?
No, I'm not. What I'm saying is a gaffe is Keir Starmer's flip-flopping on whether Diane Abbott is or is not a candidate. His flip-flopping on defence spending, his flip-flopping on border control. Those are the gaffes.
Let me tell you, because I've got to let you go. The thing they used to teach us at school is thin end of the wedge, so the narrow bit at the bottom means that the flag's not upside down. It's just a top tip for next time they do it. You're welcome.
I'm very familiar with the Union Jack.
You should have had a look at it, shouldn't you, before it went out? It's good to see you. Thanks very much indeed.